Very good morning to all the respected faculty members, chairpersons, and dear delegates. I'll be continuing the intraoperative and the postoperative management of obese patients undergoing laparoscopic surgery. So, as we have already discussed the pathophysiology and the preoperative management of these patients, so next I'll be continuing with the intraoperative and the postoperative management. As we have seen here, we have a case of a morbidly obese patient who has come for laparoscopic cholecystectomy. So how to proceed in such cases? What are the challenges we are going to face? Obesity per se presents with a different set of challenges to the anesthesiologist and the surgeons, and we should be able to have specific management plans for these patients. And laparoscopy, because of capnoperitoneum, we are going to have few complications in laparoscopic surgery with the patient in patient of obesity. So first of all, coming to the comorbid conditions, these patients frequently have comorbidities like diabetes, hypertension, ischemic heart disease, and obstructive sleep apnea is very, very common in these patients. So starting from the preoperative history taking and everything, we have to be prepared for these conditions, management of these conditions in the perioperative time. Difficult airway. Actually, these patients may or may not have difficult airway, but we should anticipate a difficult airway because it can be a difficult mask ventilation or a difficult intubation. Sometimes it may happen that you will be facing Cormac-Lehan grade 1 only after intubating the patient, but then preparation should be made and strategy should be planned beforehand to if at all you get a difficult airway, you should be able to manage that. Coming to anesthesia drug doses, drug dosing is not very straightforward in these cases because we are not going to base all the drugs on the total body weight of the patient. If at all you are going to do that, you may exceed the drug doses in many cases. So the drug doses are decided as per the lean body weight and adjusted body weight in most of the cases. We'll be discussing that in detail in further slides. Now, what is capnoperitoneum? As we all know, any laparoscopy cases, you need to insufflate carbon dioxide in the peritoneal cavity. So once that occurs, the cardiovascular system is compromised, not only cardiovascular, but the respiratory, actually the whole cardiorespiratory system is compromised because of capnoperitoneum. And in obesity, already the patients have a compromised cardiorespiratory system, as you have seen in the previous lecture. So the problems get accentuated because of the capnoperitoneum in these patients. It is advisable to plan extubation in awake state for these patients because we do not want any postoperative desaturations and recovery should be done in HDUs or properly in intensive care units, not only in wards. Postoperative pain management is very crucial in these patients because that will encourage the proper respiratory movement of these patients, and opioid-free anesthesia is preferred to prevent any post-operative desaturations for these patients. Early ambulation and DVT prophylaxis is very, very important in these patients. These patients are at an increased risk, like 10 times risk is increased for venous thromboembolism in these patients. Obesity in itself is a prothrombotic state. So the chances of MI, stroke, and venous thromboembolism is very, very high in these patients. In this table, we'll be discussing the physiological effects of capnoperitoneum. So as I've already told, the cardiovascular and the respiratory system is compromised much more than other systems. What happens because of the increased intra-abdominal pressure, there is pooling in the legs and venous return is decreased. Systemic vascular resistance is increased. Both of these factors will lead to a decrease in the cardiac output. And there is increased risk of arrhythmias because of capnoperitoneum. When these peritoneal stress receptors are activated, the arrhythmias can occur. And more so in the obese patient, what happens is that there is already sinoatrial node dysfunction and there is fatty infiltration of the conducting system. So patients are already prone for arrhythmias. There is 1.5 times more risk of atrial fibrillation in obese patients as compared to their non-obese counterparts. So you can understand how much the cardiovascular system is at risk in this obese patients. And there is increased incidence of sudden cardiac death also in these patients. Coming to the respiratory system, again, because the diaphragm is pushed up, the airway pressures are increased, the functional residual capacity is decreased, overall pulmonary compliance is decreased, and ventilation perfusion mismatches increased in these patients. Now, these effects of capnoperitoneum is accentuated with the already obese patients in the because they have atelectasis and increased ventilation perfusion mismatch beforehand. So the problems are going to get multiplied because of obesity as well as laparoscopy cases. Gastrointestinal, there is increased risk of regurgitation in these patients. Intracranial pressures and cerebral perfusion pressures are also raised. So it's not that laparoscopy surgery is only associated with problems and difficulties. There are many benefits of laparoscopy surgery, and basically the benefits outweigh the risks. So most of the surgeons as well as the patients and the anesthesiologists will prefer patients undergoing laparoscopy surgery. So what are the benefits we are going to see here? There are small surgical wounds. So the wound is small. Tissue trauma is less because of the less tissue handling. Pain is less. Post-operative pulmonary complications are less. Post-operative ileus is less. Patients are mobilized early, shorter hospital stay, and better cosmetic results. So we have far more benefits than risks in these patients. So we have to take care of the risks and go ahead with laparoscopy surgery in these patients. Coming to the intraoperative preparations. So first of all, patient comes to laparoscopic cholecystectomy. You can encourage them to walk and reduce trolley transfers. What happens that the trolley transfers in itself is a very cumbersome job in these patients. So a patient who's coming for a cholecystectomy is an elective procedure. Patient, you can talk to the patient, ask him to walk to the OT table. And it's better if the patient can position himself or herself directly on the operating table. This will reduce the chances of injuries. The weight limits of the surgical tables and trolleys and all the electrically operated equipment should be checked beforehand. And an inflatable hover mattress or hover mat can be used for lateral transfers of the patient if at all needed. This is a pneumatic device, pneumatic compression device, which can be used for transferring the patients. If you are taking an obese patient, you have to have suitably sized theater gowns to maintain patient's dignity, and extra care and time should be there for positioning these patients. So you always need increased number of OT personnel when you are taking these cases. So anytime you are having these cases, you should have a proper planning. You should check all the instruments inside, all the weight bearing trolleys and beds have to be checked before shifting these patients. It is better to have experienced surgeon and experienced anesthetist also inside the OT theater. So as here you can see, the two OT tables are joined together to increase the weight capacity of the OT table. And this is the hover mat, which I talked in the previous slide. This is a pneumatic device. This can be used for transferring the patient from bed to the trolleys for lateral transfers. Now, as per AAGBI guidelines, you do not need any extra monitoring in this patient. Only routine monitoring is indicated. But you should have adequate size of NIBP cuffs. Extra large cuff should be there. If you are using a small cuff, it will be giving you higher recordings, which is not true. And if at all you are not finding adequate size of cuff, you can use the BP cuff on the forearm. Invasive arterial monitoring is not recommended otherwise, but only if you are not able to find a proper NIBP cuff, you can go for invasive arterial monitoring. Or if the case demands, you can go for invasive arterial monitoring. Not in this case. In laparoscopic cholecystectomy, you may not need this invasive monitoring. Same goes with the CVP catheters. If you have a peripheral IV access, there is no need of CVP catheters. But at times, you may not be able to find a peripheral IV access. Then you may have to go for CVP catheters. Or if the case demands, you may have to go. It is better to have neuromuscular monitoring in these patients because most of the neuromuscular blockers, they do not act same way as they act in the non-obese patients. So it is better to have a neuromuscular monitoring, and the patient should have a proper reversal before awakening these patients. This monitoring can also be kept because the chances of awareness is much more in obese patients as compared to the non-obese counterparts. Most of these patients are diabetic, so blood sugar monitoring should be available, and warming devices should also be kept. Coming to the positioning of these patients. So first of all, as you can see here, reverse Trendelenburg position is very important at all the times. That will improve the respiratory mechanics by shifting the diaphragm downwards. And another, for intubation, you will need this ramped position, also called as HELP position, head elevated laryngoscopy position for these patients. So we'll see how this stacking has to be done so that your external auditory meatus, this tragus, has to come in line with the sternal angle. So this will make the oropharyngeal axis in the straight line. And the strapping has to be done properly so that these patients do not slide from the OT table. They are very susceptible to brachial plexus, ulnar nerve, and sciatic neuropathy. So you should have proper compression, you should have proper padding, soft foam and gel pad should be put to avoid any kind of injuries. Now, intravenous access might be difficult in these patients. It is prudent to take at least 2 intravenous cannulae when the patient is in OT. You may use ultrasound if you are not able to find peripheral IV veins because of the subcutaneous fat. You can use ultrasound and cannulate the veins. If at all you are not able to find IV access, then you may have to go for a central venous cannulation in these patients. Then coming to pre-oxygenation, it is always advised to have a 25 to 30 degree head up position. And it's head up means I do not mean that breaking the table and only head up. It should be proper reverse Trendelenburg. That is head up and feet down for these patients. This will increase the end expiratory volume around 2-fold as compared to the supine position. And you can also use a CPAP of 10 centimeter water during pre-oxygenation. NIV mask may be used for pre-oxygenation. This will improve the functional residual capacity. As you know, the FRC is less in these patients. So we have to take all the measures to improve the functional residual capacity. This will increase the safe apnea period of these patients. And pulmonary compliance and oxygenation is also improved. Morbidly obese patients should be instructed to take deep vital capacity breaths during pre-oxygenation. And apneic oxygenation should also be considered to extend the safe apnea period. Now, as here you can see, these are the 3 positions we'll be discussing. This is reverse Trendelenburg, this is supine, and this is only head up position. So as you can see here, the safe apnea period is markedly increased when you have this reverse Trendelenburg position as compared to supine or this head up position. And the recovery time from desaturation is also less in this reverse Trendelenburg position. Saturation, lower saturation reached is also high in this position. So what happens, the respiratory mechanic is improved in this reverse Trendelenburg position. So this is the preferred position. And luckily for laparoscopic cholecystectomy, the surgeon also wants this position. They will want head up and right up. So for these cases, it is very easy. For other laparoscopic cases, when they want head down, then it will be a little difficult in the intraoperative period. But in this case, you will also have easy access because the surgeons also want the same position for surgery. Coming to induction and intubation. So it is better to avoid long-acting opiates and benzodiazepines. Now what happens, because most of these patients have obstructive sleep apnea beforehand. So they are prone to have, they are already having chronic hypoxemia and hypercapnia. So when you are using opiates, benzodiazepines, they are prone to have desaturation episodes or hyperventilation episodes in the perioperative period. So it is better to, if possible, you can give opioid-free anesthesia. But if you are using, it is better to have short-acting opioids. Anesthetic agents with a rapid offset like desflurane and remifentanil should be considered in these patients. Pharmacodynamic effect of anesthetic and analgesic agents is notoriously difficult to predict. And drug dose calculation is much more difficult in the morbidly obese. So for discussing how do we calculate drug doses in this patient, we'll first discuss few definitions. What is total body weight? That is the actual weight of the patient. So what he or she is actually weighing on the weight scale is the total body weight of the patient. What is ideal body weight? This is the weight the patient should weigh with a normal ratio of lean to fat mass. So it is calculated as height minus X, where X is 105 in females and 100 in males. So suppose the height is 150 centimeter. So it becomes 150 minus 100. So 50 kgs for males and 150 minus 100 by 45 kgs for females. So that is the ideal body weight. Lean body weight is the patient's weight excluding the fat. Many of the formulae for calculating is complex. This is the simplest one. Actually, this is also complex, but this is simplest of the all the formulae for lean body weight. Adjusted body weight, it takes into account the fact that obese individuals have increased lean body mass. And so it is actually ideal body weight plus 0.4 times the extra weight. That is total body weight minus ideal body weight. So that becomes the adjusted body weight of the patient. So these all definitions are important because you will be calculating your drugs based on these definitions. See, here we can discuss a 150 kg man who is 170 centimeter tall. So here you can see the differences. The total body weight is 150 kg. What is the patient weighing actually? Lean body weight, as per the formula, it comes around 80 kg. So you can see the huge difference. It is almost double lean body weight and total body weight. Ideal body weight will come 170 minus 100 for males and 105 for females. So it will be either 65 kg or 70 kg. So you can see how much difference we have. So if you are calculating a drug which has to be calculated as per the lean body weight and you are calculating as per the total body weight, so you'll be giving almost double the amount of drug which you have to give. And this is going to cause deleterious effects for the patients. Okay, so you should be very clear about the formulas, and you should calculate. Basically, when you are taking these patients, you should have all the drugs calculated as per the rates, and you should put the chart inside the OT for that particular case, so that you do not have to calculate again and again. You can see here, the normal weight patients will have a total body weight consisting of lean and adipose weight, where the lean body weight will be 80% and adipose will be 20%. So it comes around 4:1 ratio. But in obese patients, what happens? That to compensate for this increased adipose weight, the lean body weight will also increase. So it comes in a ratio of 3:2. So this is the difference. So the lean body weight is increased in the obese patient as compared to the normal individual. Then the highly lipophilic drugs like phenytoin, midazolam, voriconazole, or propofol, they will distribute extensively into the adipose tissue, which will result in a larger volume of distribution as compared to less lipophilic drugs. But the adipose tissue is not going to take part in the metabolism because there is less blood supply to this tissue. Drugs with a larger volume of distribution will require loading doses like propofol. They will require loading doses first. All the induction agents, we have to give loading doses followed by a constant dose rate to maintain the steady state plasma concentrations. And these steady state concentrations are dependent on drug clearance. So this is the suggested dosing for anesthetic drugs. These drugs have to be decided as per the lean body weight, which will maximum come 100 kg for females, 100 kg for males and 70 kg for females. Adjusted body weight, which is ideal plus 40% of the excess weight. These drugs have to be calculated as per the adjusted body weight and total body weight for succinylcholinium and low molecular weight heparin. So it is always better to put a chart for that particular patient inside your OT when you are dealing with such a case. So this is the ramp position we were talking about. The ear position, that is the tragus level, has to come in the level with sternum. So you have to put some sheets or bolsters or pillows so that this position has to be achieved. Sometimes after achieving this position, you might find that laryngoscopy was very easy. But then you have to always get preparation done to get such a view. So intubate in ramp position. Minimize the induction to ventilation interval to avoid desaturations. You have to always keep this in mind that the safe apnea period is very less in these patients. So you have to minimize all the times here. Use shorter acting agents, and lung recruitment should be done after intubation and before extubation, followed by sufficient PEEP. Even if the saturation is normal, it is advised to do lung recruitment. You should always be prepared with a difficult airway card. So video laryngoscopes, bougies, if needed, fiber optic scopes may also be required, and you may have to consider awake intubation in these patients. Supraglottic airway is very, very important, may help as a rescue device in these patients. So again, you can see here stacking. See, without stacking, how the patient is lying, how difficult the airway looks here, and after stacking, how does the airway looks here. So standard asleep intubation is practicable and safe in this patient. Only if needed, like if you are not at all sure of having, you are feeling that you may have a can't ventilate, can't intubate situation, then go for awake intubation in these patients. Difficulties may be encountered during mask ventilation, and it can be overcome either by a four-handed technique. That means two people, one person will be holding the mask by both the hands and the other person will be ventilating the patient. Or you may put the patient on ventilator with the mask, and you may also use oral airway or nasal airway in these patients. Laryngoscopy and intubation may be straightforward with normal laryngeal anatomy, but always preparation has to be there for difficult airways. Coming to the maintenance of anesthesia, maintenance has to be commenced promptly after induction of anesthesia with air or oxygen, because this is a laparoscopic case, it is better to use air, and neuromuscular blockers have to be used. You can go for short-acting opioids like remifentanil or dexmedetomidine infusion in these patients. Desflurane or sevoflurane have a faster onset and offset than isoflurane, so they are preferred. And it has also been found that the return of airway reflexes is faster with desflurane as compared with sevoflurane. So if you are having access to desflurane, go with desflurane in these patients. These patients are also at an increased risk of awareness under anesthesia. So we'll be discussing that in the next slide. Dexmedetomidine may help minimize or eliminate the intraoperative use of opioids in the bariatric surgery, so thus improving the safety profile in the postoperative period. This has been proven in many studies. So if you are taking these patients, you may decrease the use of opioids by using dexmedetomidine. And use of short acting agents like remifentanil, sebo, and des have helped to aid rapid recovery from anesthesia and minimize post-operative hypoventilation and hypoxemia. So what is accidental awareness under anesthesia? These patients, they have very high incidence of this phenomenon because of rapid redistribution of induction agents into the larger fat mass. So if you are giving induction agents, it is always, you should give either start with the volatile after an induction agent, or you have to give another top-up dose before intubating the patient. The blood volume, cardiac output, renal perfusion, and GFR is also increased in these patients. And patients wake up more quickly than the non-obese patients after a single bolus dose during induction. So the this AGA incidence is very much high during induction in these cases. So you have to take proper precautions to prevent this. Intraoperative ventilation, you have to have strategies to ensure normocapnia and prevent hypercapnia and acidosis, which will occur during pneumoperitoneum. So that we do by decreasing the tidal volume, and you may have to increase the respiratory rate. So in these patients, you have to give tidal volume as per the ideal body weight. Don't go by the total body weight of the patient. 6 to 10 ml per kg as per the ideal body weight of the patient. Saturation, you should aim to maintain saturation of more than 90%. If required, you can go for 10 to 15 centimeter water, so optimal PEEP for this patient, because they already have an atelectatic lung and pneumoperitoneum will accentuate that. So you may have to have higher PEEP in these patients. Aim to keep the plateau pressures less than 30 centimeters of water. And it has been found that equal ratio ventilation, that is I is to A ratio 1:1, improves the arterial oxygenation by increasing the PaO2, the mean pressures, and the dynamic compliance as compared to our conventional 1:2 I is to E ratios. So there has been no superiority of pressure controlled ventilation over the volume control. But one advantage of pressure control is you can have lower peak inspiratory pressures because the pressures are under your control. So it has been observed. And if pressure control is combined with the equal ratio ventilation, it has been found to have little advantage over volume control mode. There is no significant difference in terms of oxygenation or ventilation when both the modes are compared. And it is better to give recruitment maneuver for intubation, after intubation and before extubation. That means you have to recruit the atelectatic lung by sustaining the pressures for around 35 to 40 seconds. Aim is to keep the alveolus and airways open for these patients. Coming to emergence from anesthesia, the reversal of neuromuscular block should be guided by a nerve stimulator, because as I have talked before, the neuromuscular blocking drugs, their metabolism is unpredictable in these patients. So it is better to have a neuromuscular monitoring in these patients. The aim is to have a motor capacity restored before waking these patients, and patients should have return of their airway reflexes. Breathing with good tidal volumes before extubation should be preferred. If you have a confirmed OSA case, like in this case, which we are discussing, insertion of a nasopharyngeal airway before waking helps mitigate this partial airway obstruction of these patients. Extubation, it is recommended to extubate the patient in a 30 to 45 degree head up position. That is, again, you should have a reverse Trendelenburg position before extubating. Perform on fully awake patients. So until unless indicated, go for awake extubation. And it is better to give CPAP during extubation so that the lungs can be recruited because of that also. Aspirate the nasogastric tube before extubating and be prepared for desaturation episodes as per the Difficult Airway Society guidelines. Immediately post-anesthesia care, patient should be managed in the sitting position or with a 45 degree tilt. Oxygen therapy should be applied to maintain the preoperative level. So you should know what is the preoperative saturation of the patient, and you should have your oxygen titrated to maintain at least to that level, and continue until the patient is mobile post-operatively. So until the patient is mobile, you should continue the oxygen therapy. Specifically, watch for developing hypercapnia in these patients. If the patient was using CPAP therapy at home, it should be reinstated on return to the ward. So you should ask the patient to bring their CPAP machine. And even if the patient is maintaining saturation, it is better to use CPAP therapy if the patient was on it beforehand. So you can see how the patient is put in HDO, what is the position of the patient, how he is lying down, and supplemental oxygen and pulse oximetry monitoring is very, very essential. Opioid analgesics, it is better to avoid because they have a respiratory depressant effect, and in post-operative period, we do not want that. Multimodal analgesia is preferred for these patients, paracetamol, NSAIDs, and you can have liberal infiltration at the surgical site. If at all you are using narcotics, you can use patient controlled analgesia. And if indicated, epidural anesthesia can be put in these patients. So multimodal analgesia protocol will reduce the opioid-related adverse events from 33.3 to 8.8%. So that is a huge difference. So we should all try to have opioid-free anesthesia for these patients. For discharge, this patient should be safe to return to ward only when the routine discharge criteria are met. The respiratory rate is normal. There are no periods of apnea or hypopnea for at least 1 hour. And the arterial oxygen saturation returns to the preoperative values with or without oxygen supplementation. Early mobilization is very, very vital. As we have discussed, they are at a very increased risk of venous thromboembolism. And so most patients should be out of the bed on the same day of surgery. Calf compression devices can be disconnected once the patient is mobilized. Avoid any type of intramuscular injections in these patients because of their unpredictable pharmacokinetics. So summing up everything, perioperative care may, we have already seen the preoperative assessment. You should have a multidisciplinary patient assessment. It is better to see these patients much before the patients are planned. You should not go and see the patient one day before plan. So even our surgery team should be informed if these kind of cases come, we should see the patients well in advance so that we can plan a proper strategy for these patients. Post-operative pathway should be planned in the preoperative time itself. Intraoperatively, we should be ready for difficult intubation. Protective ventilation like low tidal volumes, moderate PEEP, and low driving pressure should be maintained. Hemodynamic monitoring as and when indicated should be used. Post-operative care, bed position as we have seen, 45 degree up. Prolonged post-anesthesia care stay may happen in these patients. Chest physiotherapy, early mobilization, and CPAP and high-flow nasal cannula may be needed in selected cases. So as obesity has become an increasing problem, it is almost like an epidemic. So we'll be facing more and more number of cases in our future, and we should be prepared to provide optimal management for these individuals. I would like to conclude by this take-home message. So always remember head-up position, even during your induction. If intraoperatively it is possible, well and good. And in the post-operative period also, you need head-up position. Correct dosing scalars of drugs and titrate to effect. So whatever doses you are calculating, that is on one side, but it is very important to see the effect of the drugs. So if you are finding that the patient is getting sedated, no need to go for more drugs because I have calculated 150 mg of propofol, so I have to give. Nothing like that. You have to titrate to effect. So if the patient is getting sedated, stop then and there itself. Use short-acting water-soluble agents for these patients. Protective ventilation strategy is very important. The less is better. Minimum sedatives, and if at all you are using, use short-acting. Monitor the neuromuscular block and anesthesia depth, TBT profile axis and early ambulation, optimum pain management, and post-operative physiotherapy. They may require post-operative intensive care, so you should inform patients beforehand about this. This we have already discussed in the previous lecture. So there is a single sheet guideline of Society for Obesity and Bariatric Anesthesia. We have divided it into different pages for visualization. So this is about the preoperative, which we have already discussed. This is the intraoperative management and the postoperative management, drug dosing. So we have already discussed all these points, but this is very handy. You should have important points are noted here. So you should go through, all of you should go through this. Post-operative care is also there. So if at all obesity hyperventilation syndrome is there, you have to make the patient sit up, avoid sedatives and opioids, and reinstate patient's own CPAP. We have already discussed it. IV opioid should be avoided, but when necessary, you should have to continue saturation and monitoring, and then you may give IV opioids. So thank you. Any doubts, you are welcome. Thank you, sir.